Hello, if you don't know me, I'm Tom. I work as a product marketing engineer, and most of the time we work on technical blogs where we explain why ClickHouse is so fast. And behind many of these blogs, for example, the subset that is listed on this slide, is always a benchmark that provides hard verifiable proof via transparency and reproducibility. And we publish all these on GitHub, and we constantly benchmark ClickHouse against itself to prove that a new feature makes ClickHouse faster, or to give guidance for existing features. For example, at the beginning of this year, we did a large input format benchmark and created an online dashboard with the results. And this is a good example of our goal to educate people, as Netflix found one of their biggest performance wins after reading that blog that inspired them to implement a native ClickHouse protocol encoding in their Java pipeline and helping them to scale to 5 petabytes of logging ingest per day. Then in summer this year, we proved through benchmarks that our updates are now over 1,000 times faster. We also benchmark ClickHouse against our competitors. At the beginning of this year, we did an extensive benchmark of our new JSON implementation against other JSON data stores. Also for that, we built an online dashboard, and JSON Bench is quite established now in the community, and our competitors try to score well there unsuccessfully so far. Another constant benchmarking workstream is to dispel the common disbelief that ClickHouse is not good in joins. In summer this year, we also benchmarked our new fast updates against Postgres. And our latest benchmark iteration is an ongoing project that we call Bench to Cost. And I will present our latest results and insights in the rest of this presentation now. And the motivation is quite simple. Ranking commercial cloud database systems purely by runtime, like in ClickBench, is not enough anymore. As an example, if Cloud Data Warehouse A is faster than Cloud Data Warehouse B, but A is 3 times more expensive than B, is A really better? So maybe you could simply pay 3 times more for B to get a larger instance size from the vendor, more compute, and then B is maybe faster than A, which makes the pure runtime comparison of cloud database systems a little bit meaningless. So what potential customers really should care about is cost efficiency. Where do you get the most performance for each dollar spent? We often hear from teams that migrate to ClickHouse Cloud that cost efficiency is the number one reason. We got curious and wanted to compare 5 major cloud data warehouses in cost efficiency. And the lowest hanging fruit to do so was to take existing ClickBench runtimes, apply prices from public price lists, and then derive costs. And I say lowest hanging fruit because we already have all the runtimes for 43 analytical queries in ClickBench for 70 different database systems, including all commercial major cloud data warehouses. And similarly, we also have runtimes for 8 databases with first-class JSON support in JSONBench. And the price lists for the 5 main cloud data warehouses we were initially interested in, they are all public. So we can take these prices and map them over the query runtimes in ClickBench, right? It's not that simple, unfortunately, because each price list shows prices not for runtimes, but something completely different. We can see terms like credits, DBUs, compute units, RPUs, slots. And so basically every system invents its own billing unit. Snowflake bills in credits, Databricks uses DBUs, Databricks units. ClickHouse Cloud uses compute units, and BigQuery uses slots, and Redshift uses RPUs, Redshift processing units. And these are not just different labels for the same thing. Each billing unit maps to a completely different compute model with a different query engine architecture under the hood, meaning that the same query can burn radically different amounts of compute depending on which engine it runs on. And if you're curious about the engine details, every one of these systems has a concise research paper, also ClickHouse, and each paper documents how that engine works internally. And I took the architecture diagrams from these papers. So we first need to decode these billing models to understand how billing units map to compute. And then as a second step, we can do the reverse and convert the compute used in existing ClickBench results into corresponding billing units, and then take ClickBench runtimes and add price tags. So let's take a quick look under the hood of these billing units. I'm super quick here because that's not really super important. So Snowflake builds compute using credits consumed by what it calls warehouses. So you pick a warehouse size upfront and then pay for its uptime, not per query. And each warehouse size determines how many compute nodes you get and how many credits per hour are burned. And the price is then a fixed dollar amount per credit per hour, depending on addition, cloud, and region. The numbers on all these slides here are on AWS US East. Then Databricks follows the same core model as Snowflake. You choose a warehouse size and you pay for uptime, not per query. Billing unit is DBU, Databricks unit, and each warehouse size maps to a fixed number of executor nodes and a fixed DBU burn rate per hour. And then the cost is simply the number of DBUs times the runtime times price per DBU per hour. Then ClickHouse Cloud uses provisioned clusters, but without fixed warehouse sizes. So instead, compute is sized along two independent dimensions. First, how many nodes are run, and second, how big each node is. And to make this billable, ClickHouse defines a normalized compute unit as one unit is two CPU cores and each GB of RAM. And then the total burn rate is the number of nodes times the number of compute units per node. And again, you pay a fixed dollar amount per compute unit per hour, depending on tier, cloud, and region. Then BigQuery works very differently. There are no user-visible clusters. Queries run on a shared serverless compute fabric, and the billing unit is a slot, which is approximately a logical execution thread. And for each query stage, BigQuery dynamically allocates as many slots as makes sense. So different stages get different slot counts, and billing is based on the total used slot seconds. As an example, you can imagine a query with a wall clock runtime of 20 seconds, and the scan phase maybe took 12 seconds and got run with 1,000 slots. Then this is consumed. Then this consumed 12,000 slot seconds. Then the aggregation stage took 6 seconds and was run with 600 slots. Then this consumed 3,600 slot seconds. And the final merge took maybe 2 seconds with 4 parallel slots, which consumed 8 slot seconds. So in total, that 20-second query got built with around 15,000 slot seconds. And then you pay a fixed price per slot time. BigQuery alternatively also has byte-scanned pricing model, where you pay purely for how much table data your query reads. And BigQuery still schedules and runs slots internally, but the on-demand pricing model ignores slot usage completely. And lastly, Redshift Serverless is the second serverless shared compute system that we looked at. It builds an RPU's Redshift processing units, and each RPU is a fixed bundle of CPU and memory, and AWS uses a predictive machine learning-based model to decide how many RPUs a query gets. Again, as an example, let's say a query arrives, and the predictive scaling model selects 16 RPUs to run the query with, and the query runtime is 60 seconds. Then in total, that 60-second query gets built with 960 RPU seconds, and you pay a fixed price per RPU time, depending on region. Okay, so good so far. So far, so good. We now understand how each system maps its billing units to compute. But before I move on to the second step, I want to do a very short detour, because while digging into these compute models, we noticed that the systems differ a lot in how far compute can be scaled for a single query. So BigQuery and Redshift are serverless systems. They allocate compute for you automatically. However, for the provision cluster systems, their ability to scale compute per single query is differently. So Snowflake and Databricks behave similarly. When you have a warehouse, you can manually scale it up, but the size has a hard t-shirt size cap, and then you can add additional clusters, but these are separate for a single query, meaning that more warehouses can increase query throughput, but not per query performance. And when queries arrive concurrently, then they can be distributed over separate clusters, but the single query can only be run by a single cluster. Whereas in ClickHouse Cloud, it's much more flexible. Node sizing is continuous and automatic based on CPU and memory pressure. You can start with a tiny node, make them larger, and then up to 90 CPU cores. Here on the slide, you see a node with 32 cores. And then you can add as many nodes as you want. It's basically unlimited at the moment. And when queries arrive concurrently, they can be distributed over the available CPU cores. But a single query can use all available cores of all nodes via our parallel replicas feature in the cloud. So that was the quick detour about how far compute can be scaled. And now that we understand how the billing units are mapped to compute, we can do the inverse and first look up the size of compute, use the clickbench results, map it back to corresponding billing units, and then apply the pricing rules and add price tags. And what you see on this slide is fully automated with our bench to cost scripts for systems using a provisioned cluster compute model like Snowflake, Databricks, and ClickHouse Cloud. We take the existing clickbench result files and see how much compute was allocated by reading the machine and cluster size infos. Then we map these used compute sizes to the corresponding billing units. And then we apply the public price per unit per hour. And that lets us calculate the cost of every single query and then produce enriched clickbench results that now include price tags, not just run times. And then for the two systems with serverless shared compute model, BigQuery and Redshift serverless, we needed to extend the clickbench runner and then had to rerun clickbench. I showed this here just for BigQuery, but we did basically the same also for Redshift serverless. So for BigQuery, we used the BigQuery command line client to rerun the clickbench queries. Here you see how we rerun one of the 43 queries. And then we used the BigQuery command line client to fetch the pure server-side query runtime, the used slot time, and the byte scanned for running the query. This is the result for the example. So the pure runtime was 665 milliseconds, but the used slot time was 149 seconds. And you can also see how much byte BigQuery scanned for running the query. And these additional metrics, the build slot seconds for BigQuery and the build RPU seconds for Redshift serverless, are captured in extended clickbench result files. And once we had those, we could apply the public price lists and attach real per query costs to the benchmark results. So if you want a full deep dive, you will find every detail even more in this blog. Now it's time, for the fun part, the results. Super briefly, I have to mention some methodology info. So the presented results could have exploded into too many combinations of different t-shirt sizes, cluster shapes, pricing tiers, regions, and so on. So to keep the results fair and consistent, we defined representative configurations. Snowflake and Databricks get 3 warehouse sizes each to capture the full range. Because Cloud has no, like I said, warehouse sizes, and we use one fixed configuration per dataset size. BigQuery appears twice because it has 2 billing models, and Redshift serverless, we use its default configuration. Then we priced everything for the same region for the enterprise tiers, and we assume perfect per second billing for all systems. While in reality, Snowflake, Databricks, and ClickHouse Cloud stop billing only when compute stops after a configurable idle timeout, and BigQuery and Redshift serverless have per second billing with a 1 minute minimum window. And I mentioned that bench to cost can be applied to existing clickbench results, but actually we created new benchmark results over larger versions of the clickbench dataset because the default dataset has only 100 million rows, which is a bit tiny. And then here as an example for today's datasets, ClickPy, our Python client telemetry dataset, has already surpassed 2 trillion rows. And with ClickHouse Cloud, we also benchmarked the 1 trillion row dataset version. But for the other systems at that scale, their costs are so high that we would have probably got a call from finance team. So for now, we stopped at 100 billion rows. All right, let me show you the overall bench to cost result. So we visualize it here in a kind of Gartner quadrant style. And to mimic this layout where the leaders sit on the top right, we had to flip the coordinate system. So the origin is in the top right, not the bottom left. The x-axis sits at the top, the y-axis on the right. The x-axis shows runtime in seconds. It's the sum of the runtimes for all 43 queries together. And the runtime values increase as you move left. The y-axis shows the total cost in dollars, also for running all 43 clickbench queries together. And the values increase as you move down. And also note that both axes are in log scale, meaning that small movements already mean big differences in speed or cost. And for more clarity and focus, we don't show the ticks. And with that, at the top right, we have the leader quadrant where systems are fast with low costs. Systems in the quadrant below are fast but have high costs. systems in the top left quadrant are slow with low costs, and at the bottom left is the losers quadrant, where systems are slow and have high costs. And so for this overall results animation, we only show the fastest configuration per system. And as we push to larger scales, to 10 billion and then to 100 billion rows, we can see that every major cloud data warehouse drifts into the slow and high cost quadrant, except ClickHouse Cloud. Let's watch it one more time. Okay, and boom, 100 billion. Okay, so these are the concrete numbers for all system configurations, not just for the fastest ones, for the 1 billion rows run. So for 1 billion rows, most systems, they cluster in the fast and low cost quadrant, but still with very different value per dollar profiles. Remember that both axes are log scale, where small distances between the dots already mean big differences in speed or cost. And so ClickHouse Cloud is the fastest, and at the low end of cost, the other systems are slower and you need to spend more. And here you see the cost performance score ranking of the systems for the 1 billion rows runs. So this score is the runtime multiplied by cost, and the smaller value is better. And this metric captures the intuition behind our initial question, where do you get the most performance for each dollar spent? So fast systems score better, low-cost systems score better, and fast and low-cost systems score the best. And at 1 billion row scale, ClickHouse Cloud has the best score, and everything else is at least 2 times worse. At 10 billion rows, the systems already drift out of fast and low cost quadrant, and ClickHouse is again the fastest system with the lowest cost, and the next best system in the same quadrant is 10 times slower. Also at the 10 billion row scale, ClickHouse Cloud has the best cost performance score, everything else is at least 7 times worse, and at 100 billion rows, ClickHouse Cloud is the only system that remains in the fast and low cost region. Every other system becomes way slower, way more expensive, and ClickHouse Cloud remains the clear leader with at least 23 times better cost performance score than the other systems. So you get the most bang for your buck with ClickHouse Cloud. And that would most likely look even better at even larger scales, trillions of rows. And so this here is now the core takeaway for you, your take home message. Public price lists don't tell you real costs, compute models do. Public price lists are meaningless because different cloud data warehouses with different billing units, different compute models, and different engines scale and burn compute in completely different ways. And so serverless systems like BigQuery and Redshift, they both can throw huge amounts of parallel compute at the query instantly, which looks fast, but means a lot of total compute consumed. Whereas Snowflake, Databricks, and ClickHouse, they use provision clusters where the total cost is basically the cluster size times the runtime. But here, efficiency decides the winner. ClickHouse simply does more work per CPU cycle, finishes sooner, burns far less compute overall, which is why it consistently ends up also with the lowest cost. And this is the main insight. ClickHouse Cloud gives customers the most bang for their buck. And again, if you want a full deep dive, you will find all the details in the second block. And you can even explore the complete result with our interactive benchmark explorer, where you can freely mix and match vendors, tiers, clusters, dataset scales, and explore the complete results.